Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of the FOCSI Perinatology Committee, I welcome you all to this webinar on RH ISO immunization. I must really congratulate Dr. Vaishali Chauhan, Chairperson FOCSI Perinatology Committee, for conducting these series of webinars. And I must say that we have literally lost the count of the number of webinars. She has always made POJS proud. And it's definitely a proud privilege to invite Dr. Vaishali Chauhan, Madam, to introduce our guest of honor.
Thank you, dear Ashwini, for a very kind introduction and a very warm welcome to you all for this Perinatology Committee FOCSI webinar on RH negative pregnancy and RPN. Thank you to TOG Science Integra and to our academic partners, Bharat Serum. Grateful to our very dynamic president, Dr. Alpesh Gandhi, sir, for this opportunity. To all our VPs, to my VP, especially Dr. Archana Basel, ma'am, she's here with us today, and Dr. Ragini Agarwal, who's here, and all the VPs, and Dr. Jaydeep Tank, who have always encouraged us to conduct this program. And thank you for one ICOG credit point, which we have received, Dr. Meg, madam, and Dr. Parag Binivale. And before we go on, I would just like to very briefly tell about a few words about the work done by my committee over the past 3.5 years. Perinatology Committee FOCSI has done a lot of work in association with other bodies like IAP, NNF. We did a program called Saath Saath with IAP. We did NRP, neonatal resuscitation programs all over the country, hands-on drills and workshops with NNF. We also launched a FOCSI focus on preterm labor. We did more than 100 CMEs in the first year of my tenure, when we used to travel every weekend to different cities right from north to south of India. And during this year, under a very dynamic leadership of Alpesh sir, Archana Basel ma'am, Ragini ma'am, Perinatology Committee was got the opportunity to conduct an international conference over a period of 2 days with international faculty. We did public forum, social programs, paper presentation with more than 150 papers from senior consultant level, quiz, slogans, skits, a lot of competitions, drawings, and of course an entire day of dedicated scientific program. In association, we had done this with IAP and NNF during the month of November, which was the month of preterm labor. So thank you, Alpesh sir and FOCSI, for this opportunity. And during this year, we have been doing repeated webinars and social activities, academic activities. So I would like to proceed ahead and welcome our chief guest, Alpesh sir. Sir is not here right now. He's held up in a meeting. But sir has done revolutionary work, and he is real visionary who has encouraged all of us 27 chairpersons to go out of the way and contribute and do work. And he has been instrumental in the revolutionary victory which we have had as FOCSIans, that COVID-19 vaccine is allowed for lactating mothers. And we are also stressing the advocacy that it should be allowed for pregnant women. Sir was the first to work on COVID-19 guidelines and with ICMR, and sir is doing great work in high-risk pregnancy. So unfortunately, sir is not here today. I would like to welcome our two guests of honors, Dr. Archana Basel, ma'am. She is my VP, and I have been working under madam's guidance and a lot of encouragement, lot to learn from you, ma'am. The different things that you do and the multidimensional personality that you are. Ma'am is also organizing secretary of AICOG 2021 Indore. She is fellow representative AICCRCOG West Zone, and she was Imaging Science Committee Chairperson. She was also organizing secretary of ISAR 2016, and she's managing committee member of ISAR 2018-20 IAG and ICOG. Welcome, ma'am. I would also like to introduce our second guest of honor, Dr. Ragini Agarwal. Ma'am is Vice President FOCSI, and ma'am has been very encouraging, very inspiring, the monumental work that ma'am is doing. She is fellow clinical gynec endoscopy UK master course cosmetic gynecology and laser, clinical director OBGYN, head of department cosmetic gynecology at Pratiksha Hospital Gurgaon, senior consultant AA Derma Science Advanced Clinic for Women Health Gurgaon. She is founder Gurgaon OBGY Society, founder president Haryana Association of OBGY, president elect Aesthetic Regenerative Society India, and she's patron of Gurgaon Menopause Society and many organizations she is heading. So welcome both of our very esteemed guest of honor, and I would like to welcome our guest of honors to say a few words and give us their advice. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. At the outset, let me congratulate Dr. Vaishali Chauhan for the phenomenal work she has done as a perinatology committee chair. I think I have witnessed the amount of enthusiasm she has. The 2 days conference was really very good conference with so many faculties and good deliberations. So hats off to you, Vaishali. And I acknowledge here my co-vice president, Dr. Ragini Agrawal, chairpersons, Dr. Kiran, Dr. Chinmay, and speakers of today, Dr. Raut, Dr. Priyankur Roy, and all the panelists who are there. They are all very learned panelists are here, Dr. Mitra, Dr. Ashwini, Dr. Selva, and our endocrinology committee chair, Dr. Ritu. And I think you have collected galaxy of stars today to talk about this topic. And I'm really grateful to Science Integra and Bharat Serum for having collaborated with FOCSI Perinatology Committee to bring up this beautiful webinar, because RH isoimmunization is still relevant. We know that we have been giving NTD, but sometimes, you know, you miss out. So it is very important. And I think the deliberations today are going to be really beneficial to all the delegates. And as Vaishali has said, that we are looking forward to do AICOG 2021, which is going to be happening in 2022, physical rather than, you know, the webinars, because we are dying to meet personally. This year has been an extraordinary year. We are going to finish our term soon without seeing each other. So I think we are really all very desperate to meet. So all the best and congratulations, Vaishali. And I'll stay safe, and I look forward to see you all in person at Indore.
Thank you, ma'am, for your guiding words and your warmth. And we really are dying to see you and be at Indore for this AICOG. And thank you so much for the entire tenure, the entire year. You have been a solid strength of pillar supporting us all the time, ma'am. Thank you very much. And as ma'am has said, we indeed have a galaxy of star faculty, very esteemed faculty with us today, with Dr. Raut, who is going to give a talk, and with Dr. Priyankur Roy, he is the national coordinator of my committee. Then our very esteemed panelist, Chinmay, especially the fetal expert, the topmost big name in fetal medicine, and who is going to take over from me soon on 27th of June as Perinatology Committee Chairperson. Dr. Kiran Kurtukotti is here, Vice President AMOGS, so very esteemed people. And for panelists, we of course have Mitra Ma'am and Dr. Ritu, Ashwini, and Selva is joining, I think, and Dr. Sarina Gilvaz. So indeed, we look forward to a very good interactive academic session. So I hand over once again to Ashwini.
Thank you so much, madam. It's really worth appreciating the kind of efforts that you have put in through these 3 years. We're really very, very proud of you. I now request Session to please share the screen. I invite our chairpersons for the next session, Dr. Kiran Kurtukotti, who is the second vice president of AMOGS. He was the chairperson of MTP committee AMOGS 2012. He's the second joint secretary of AMOGS in 2009. He's also the organizing secretary of AMOGS held in 2018 and AMOGS Lupin Suraksha Initiative. He is the organizing chairman of FOCSI AMOGS POJ's Clinical Legal Conference, which was held in 2019, and he's got many publications and awards to his credit. We welcome you, Dr. Kiran, sir. Session the next CV, please. We have Dr. Chinmay Ratha, madam. who would be chairing the session with him. She is the director at the Resolution Fetal Medicine Center, Navodaya Hospital, and a senior consultant of fetal medicine at Yashoda Hospital, Secunderabad. She's done a FMF from UK and she's an approved trainer in India. She has many awards and publications to her credit, and as we've just heard that she's going to take the perinatology committee on 27th of June. Congratulations, madam. And I welcome you both. I request our chairpersons to introduce our speakers for the session.
Hello. Thank you at the outset. Thank you, Dr. Vaishali. Thank you, Alpesh. Thank you, Poxy, for inviting us on this particular platform. I am on behalf of my co-chairperson, Dr. Chinmayi, would welcome all of you on this particular fabulous session on in perinatology. First of all, congratulations, Dr. Vaishali, because you are really doing a fabulous job and taking a perinatology committee to the newer heights. And as everyone is aware, and I should put on record that you are one of the rising stars or already risen star of POGS. So we hope, wish and pray for your best in your future endeavors in POGSI. So I would like to invite our first esteemed speaker, Dr. Mohan Raut. Dr. Mohan Raut has got his fellowship in clinical reproductive immunology from the American Society of Reproductive Immunology. He is the editor of the Evidence-Based Women's Health Journal of Evidence-Based Women's Health Society of Egypt. He is a consultant and gynecologist at the Raut Women's Hospital. He is the trustee of the Raut Immunology Foundation at Mumbai Santa Cruz. He has been involved in active immunotherapy programs in Mumbai. He has contributed to various chapters in immunology on repeated miscarriages, has published numerous papers on national and international conference. He is the first one to start the immunotherapy center, which was recognized by the DGCI with Dr. Mrs. Mukhda Rao. Currently, we await his book on immunotherapy in repeated miscarriages and implantation failures. With this introduction, I would request Dr. Rao to talk on role of immunomodulation in unexplained RPL.
Thank you, Dr. Kiran. And thank you for inviting me for this talk. I'm thankful to the Perinatology Committee of FOCSI. In a seminar on isoimmunization or alloimmunization, and I am taking this opportunity to speak on alloimmunization of a little different kind, and that is alloimmunization in pregnancy and role of immunomodulation in recurrent pregnancy loss. I'll start with my screen share. Fine. So the topic is immunomodulation in repeated pregnancy loss. Repeated pregnancy loss is an enigma for all of us. And let us see if we can throw some light on this complicated subject, especially the unexplained type of repeated pregnancy loss and how immunology plays a role and whether immunomodulation can be the solution. We can't start to talk about reproductive immunology without mentioning Sir Peter Medawar, because he first put forward this sentence, and that is, the purpose of science is to change belief. And if you believe that infertility, implantation failures, and recurrent pregnancy loss are God's will, which is not treatable by scientifically, you will never try to find effective treatment. And it is so true. So let us begin our today's journey. What is repeated pregnancy loss? I am not going into the details, but it is two or three miscarriages. But now it is generally considered that two or more miscarriages, patients with two or more miscarriages should be labeled as repeated pregnancy loss. And so that brings us to the incidence of repeated miscarriages to around 2 to 5%. And there are different causes of miscarriages and IVF failures. And these include genetic, anatomical, infections, endocrine. But there is a big section or big part that is around 50 to 60% of the couples. All these factors are normal and they are labeled as unexplained repeated miscarriages. And these couples are sort of handed over to nature. So should we consider immunological factor in these patients and why? A brief mention about why we should mention, and it is again Sir Peter Medawar who first put forward this question, that how does a pregnant mother manage to nourish within herself for many weeks and months a fetus that is antigenically a foreign body. Because our immune system is made up of, which is protecting us, is made up of cells, tissues, organs, and it protects us against viruses, bacteria, microorganisms, or anything which is different from, antigenically different from us, from entering our body. And yet, this powerful defense system is overcome in mammals in pregnancy, where the fetus grows in mother's body without any problem. Really, it's a miracle. The important thing here is to know about the immunological equilibrium, which balances between the activation and the tolerance. And these are the two parts of immune system, which if they are in proper balance, then they help in maintaining normal pregnancy. So this immunological equilibrium is important to protect against even autoimmune and alloimmune responses. And any disturbances in this equilibrium will lead to autoimmune or alloimmune disorders. And in last 25 years, it has become absolutely clear that a large percentage of these unexplained miscarriages can be due to alloimmune cause. And more the number of miscarriages, more is the immunological problem. And with better understanding of the cellular mechanisms in the immune system, we can understand better about the immune part of this repeated pregnancy loss. And if you can see in the figure, the Th1 type of cells are important at the time. They regulate trophoblast invasion, tissue remodeling, angiogenesis. Th17, Th22 cells are important to protect trophoblasts from pathogens. The Th2 and Th9 type of cells, they promote allograft tolerance and help in continuation of pregnancy till term. And it's all these mechanisms, T regulatory cells at the top that you see, they manage, they control all these cells so that pregnancy continues successfully. And anything that goes wrong in this will lead to disturbance in pregnancy and reproductive failure. Now, let us see how we can apply this clinically. And when we talk about clinical presentations, the first thing that we consider are the guidelines. Yes, because without guidelines, we can't work. So for repeated pregnancy loss, the important guidelines are ESHRAE, ASRM, RCOG. The other two are quite old. So I am considering recurrent pregnancy loss guidelines of ESHRAE, which are also not relatively new. They are published in 2017 and where studies up to 2015 were only considered. So 6 years back. And what does it say about role of immunomodulation in repeated pregnancy loss? As you will see, the recommendations are lymphocyte immunization therapy should not be used. Intravenous immunoglobulins, not recommended. Vaginal progesterone, not helpful. Insufficient evidence for intralipids. Heparin low-dose aspirin, not recommended. Glucocorticoids, not recommended. Insufficient evidence to recommend G-CSA. Is it really so? So I'm here, an excellent review paper by Professor Howard Karp, an authority in repeated pregnancy loss, about immunotherapy in repeated pregnancy loss. And the review discusses possible immune-mediated mechanisms of pregnancy loss and the means whereby immunotherapy may modulate these mechanisms. And let's see what he says. The important thing, the first thing he mentions about the diagnostic criteria, he says there are no definitive laboratory criteria in the sense the diagnostic criteria. He mentions that the NK cells, NK cell activity, cytokine estimation, lymphocyte cross-match, and other HLA estimation, all these are important, but they are not 100% definitive. Important thing he says is to rule out all established causes, that is normal karyotype, normal glucose tolerance, uterine cavity should be normal, thyroid and function should be normal, prolactin should be normal, antiphospholipid antibody should be negative, and the most important, patients losing at least one euploid embryo. A very important thing, how we'll see a little later. He mentions that there are limitations to the trials which are conducted in this field, and most trials do not take into account the factors that affect the prognosis of repeated miscarriages, and therefore they fail to stratify accordingly. And these prognostic factors are genetic status of the embryo. In RPL, this is not usually considered. Women who miscarry chromosomally abnormal embryos have almost 3 times chance of successful live birth compared to women who miscarry chromosomally normal embryos. Very important thing. The second is number of previous miscarriages. Each miscarriage lowers the chance of live birth by 24%. And third is whether the patient is a primary aborter or secondary aborter. So these factors are important. They have impact on the prognosis, but they are never considered in the trials. And therefore, the trials don't help or they are not the ideal ones. There are various ways of immunomodulation, from active immunomodulation to lymphocyte immunization therapy, IVIG, steroids, progesterone, encephalopids, heparin, low-dose aspirin, G-CSF, so on and so forth. He has mentioned a few, 3 to 4 of these in this review. And the first he has mentioned is the lymphocyte immunization therapy. It is the first immunomodulatory treatment used to treat unexplained repeated miscarriages. And it involves immunization of the prospective mother with allogenic mononuclear cells. And it is performed using paternal or a donor lymphocytes. And the efficacy of lymphocyte LIT has been proved by various studies in the past and also in near future and in the recent past. So the recurrent miscarriage immunotherapy trialist group showed LIT significantly improved the live birth rate, which was statistically significant. Professor Karp himself in his study in meta-analysis of 5 of women with 5 or more miscarriages who were given LIT, they showed the chance of live birth significantly increased following LIT. And especially it was more pronounced in primary aborters. Daya and Ganbi also showed that certain miscarriages group with chromosomally normal embryos, LIT alone has shown increase in the live birth rate that was statistically significant. Professor Gao further mentions about the Ober study. This was a large multicentric study which was published in Lancet and which has been criticized a lot. And this study suggested that immunization with paternal mononuclear cells did not improve pregnancy outcome. And it said that the control group had 65% success while the treated group was just 46% success. And because of lack of benefit, it recommended against lymphocyte immunization therapy. But there was a lot of criticism about this study because this is the only study till date which has given negative effect of LIT on the live birth rates. This cell preparation, there were a lot of technical faults. The cell preparation, lymphocyte preparation was faulty. It was from stored lymphocytes, which destroyed the CD200 marker, which is important for immunomodulation. Then it did not exclude autoimmune disorders. ANA positive patients were not excluded. So that impacted the success rate. There was lack of post-immunization control of immunomodulation. Lymphocyte concentration doses were not proper. And therefore, it recommended against lymphocyte immunization therapy, and the subsequent Cochrane reviews also said the same thing, that any type of immunomodulation is of no use in improving the live birth rates. And as this figure shows, just 1.22 odd ratio of the Cochrane review. But there are recent meta-analysis of almost 18 to 20 studies, which were done by Liu and Cavalcante, and they have shown a significant increase in the odds ratio with lymphocyte immunization therapy. As the figure shows, Liu showed an odds ratio of 4, while Cavalcante showed an odds ratio of 3, which proved the efficacy of LIT. Is it safe? There are minor side effects, no serious allergic reactions. In fact, a large study of 4,500 patients, long-term follow-up, who had been given LIT, showed no anaphylaxis, autoimmune disease, or graft-versus-host disease. And Professor Karp said, hence, side effects do not seem to be a major problem. The second thing, method he discussed was intralipid. There is evidence that intralipid administered intravenously can enhance the implantation and maintenance of pregnancy. In fact, Professor Caroline Coulomb had done a study of patients who had reproductive failure, and he compared the use of intralipids with intravenous immunoglobulin, and the overall live birth rate or ongoing pregnancy rate was with intralipid was 61%. While IVA with IVIG, it was 56%, so it was comparable and it was good. And the advantage of intralipid was that it is relatively inexpensive and it is not a blood product. The third he discussed was G-CSF. G-CSF is a cytokine growth factor. The use of G-CSF in RPL is supported by a randomized control trial, the famous trial of Scarpellini and Brassia, where the live birth rate was 82.8% in women treated with G-CSF compared to that of just 48.5% in the control group. It's a relatively, method without side effects. No abnormality in the fetus was also detected. How does it act? It is known to increase the HCG levels. In patients who are given filgrastim, the HCG levels are increased due to direct effect on the trophoblast, and also it promotes the mobilization and proliferation of lymphocytes, dendritic cells, and T regulatory cells, which help in protection of pregnancy. The next three discuss is immunoglobulin, but I think for immunoglobulin, there is one more paper, very recent paper, which I would like to discuss with you, and that is there a role of intravenous immunoglobulin in immunological recurrent pregnancy loss? And in this review article, which was aimed at to summarize the mechanism, efficacy, pharmacokinetics, and side effects associated with passive immunization using IVIG in immunologic recurrent pregnancy loss. And he has given a list of mechanisms, almost 14 mechanisms, immunological mechanisms, through which IVIG is beneficial in patients who have repeated pregnancy loss to prevent miscarriage. He further mentions about immunoglobulins in antiphospholipid syndrome, and it was used to prevent RPL associated with APS, and a better fetal outcome was reported. In patients treated with IVIG, maternal and fetal outcome was better than even those who were treated with low-dose aspirin and heparin in this study. And IVIG has a function of neutralizing the autoantibodies. And as a result of this, it can be used in RPL patients with APS who have previously failed. So for failed patients who have failed in spite of giving heparin or aspirin, IVIG or immunoglobulins are useful. Anticoagulation is not completely effective in antiphospholipid syndrome patients, and some patients will definitely benefit when IVIG is added. What is the role of IVIG in unexplained pregnancy or immunoglobulin unexplained pregnancy? Immunoglobulin infusion could be used before conception in RPL patients who have cellular immune abnormalities like increased NK cell count, NK cell cytotoxicity, or increased T-help, TH1 to TH2 ratio. And the timing of giving immunoglobulin is also very important, whether it is given pre-conception or after conception. And immunoglobulin treatment before conception improved the chance of live delivery in primary recurrent RPL patients, whereas in secondary RPL patients, IVIG given following embryo implantation showed higher success. So what are the side effects? Yes, IVIG is associated with side effects like increased incidence of thrombosis, renal dysfunction, hemolysis, transmission of disease like the CJ disease, and certain general irritating side effects like mild headache, fatigue, nausea, vomiting, chills. So we have even the option of intramuscular immunoglobulin now, which can be used in place of intramuscular immunoglobulin. One more important aspect about immunoglobulin that this study has put forward are the challenges in IVIG studies. Why these studies are not the correct ones? Patient population included in the placebo-controlled studies and the treatment protocols performed are quite heterogeneous. The protocols are heterogeneous. The dosage of IVIG is different in different studies. The placebos used in the study, they themselves affect the outcome, and some placebos may interfere with pregnancy outcome. So it is, and also, it is again here also, it is important to rule out underlying genetic problem which can confound the final results. And the most important part, which we clinicians day in and day out face, is high quality clinical studies are difficult to perform because neither couples and nor even us obstetricians are willing to be randomly on placebo. So that ends everything. So then, should immunomodulatory treatment be used or not? So this is a very recent paper in February 2021 by Wormstein about immunological risk factors in recurrent pregnancy loss, guidelines versus current state of art. And here he compares the guidelines related to use of immunomodulation in recurrent pregnancy loss, the RCOG, ASRM, ESHRAE, and even certain European, German, Austrian, and Swiss guidelines. And the guidelines are similar like what I told you about ESHRAE. But this review paper says that there is increasing evidence that NK cells may contribute to RPL. Majority of studies, including one large meta-analysis, has shown increased levels of peripheral NK cell in patients with RPL compared to healthy controls. Several studies report higher NK cell toxicity in RPL patients before and during pregnancy. And one more important, maybe the most important, uterine NK cells are likely to be more significantly involved in the process of embryo implantation than peripheral NK cells. An increased number of uterine NK cells, especially the CD57 type of cells, were shown particularly in patients with idiopathic RPL. So this study, finally, there are certain suggestions which it has made, though it has not drastically changed from the guidelines. It has said glucocorticoids can be used in clinical studies in women with autoimmune disorders, and where previous all studies had recommended absolutely against other immunomodulatory medicines, this study recommends that IVIG, lymphocyte immunization therapy, intralipid infusions, TNF alpha blockers can be considered, but they say they're still, you should be used in clinical studies so that we can get better data about it and they can be used clinically. So finally, what Professor Howard Karp has suggested is there are certain practice points and certain research agenda. I am coming to the close of my talk. So the practice points are, when used on an unselected population of repeated miscarriages, immunomodulation does not affect the live birth rate. But the important part is, when women with repeated miscarriages are selected for a poor prognosis or immune phenomenon, that is those specific subgroups, then immunotherapy has been shown to be effective. Embryonic aneuploidy is an important cause of repeated miscarriages, which confounds many trials of immunotherapy, and this is because failure to account for this aneuploidy has precluded showing the proper, correct, positive results of immunotherapy. And lastly, there is no definite biomarker 100% which is diagnostic or predictive that which patients will respond to immunotherapy. Natural killer cell concentration and their killing activity are most often used criteria, but are not specific enough. So we need to go further on the diagnosis side. And so he recommends a research agenda where much research is needed to determine the immune and inflammatory mechanisms active in repeated miscarriages. Different types of NK cells require research. And most important, again, is the T regulatory cells may be more important than other types of cells for promoting trophoblast growth, and more research should be there in that area, which is already in progress. And different types of immunotherapy require further refinement to determine the dosage and most efficacious regimen. So before I close, what is the future of immunomodulation in RPL then? A few important points. The diagnostic test to select subgroup of patients who will be benefited by immunomodulation must be there. A common treatment or protocol should be agreed upon. Well-designed randomized controlled trials to be conducted. A global registry of all patients treated at various centers should be done. And finally, most important, a rational use of evidence-based medicine is very, very important. So here I come to the end of my talk. I am thankful for you for a patient listening. And thank you again, Perinatology Committee.
Well, thank you, Dr. Mohan Raut. It was a fabulous lecture. A few questions to you. First of all, as far as IV immunoglobulin is concerned, if at all it is to be given as per the standard criteria, how can we give it? What is the drug used and what is the regime?
See, for patients who have repeated miscarriages or for that matter,
and for that,
hello?
Go on, sir. Go on.
For patients who have repeated miscarriages or recurrent implantation failures, as I mentioned, intravenous immunoglobulin can be used for RPL patients once the pregnancy is confirmed. It can be used. There are various protocols. That is the main problem, as I said. There are protocols which use IVIG every month at the dose of around 25 grams in each dose. And there are protocols which use it every 15 days till 3 months, and then every month till 5 months. But there is no uniformity of the protocol. But this is the one protocol usually followed, is every month IVIG till at least 3 months, and then subsequently up to 5 months if required.
Achha. Any role of intermittent, I mean intramuscular immunoglobulin that is normally given every 21 days?
We have a preparation where intramuscular immunoglobulin is used. The half-life of immunoglobulin is around 15 to 20 days. Okay. So in any form, it has been found out that even the intramuscular route, when it is given, the concentration in the blood remains for almost 21 days, the therapeutic concentration. Therefore, it is recommended every 15 days. But in actual clinical use, we have used it even every 15 days, and in certain patients, even every week, when those patients who really required it. And it is free from side effects, and it's tolerated well compared to intravenous immunoglobulin.
Okay, I
wanted to ask something to sir. When you say that there will be a diagnostic test for the group of women who will benefit from immunotherapy, what kind of test are you envisaging? Will it be a blood test, or will it be a like endometrial tissue test, or how do you think you will reach that diagnosis that this patient will benefit?
Right. So there are two sets of tests. Either they will be from blood, or more important, they will be from endometry. Now, it has been found out that the endometrial tests are maybe of more importance, and they can guide us better. So endometrial estimation of the natural killer cells, that is one thing. The particular type of, see, there are CD56 types of natural killer cells, which are important cells for, from pregnancy point of view, that are important for implantation and the arteriolar remodeling. And if they are not there, there will be miscarriage. But if their activity is excess or it continues, now nature is great. You saw that diagram where Th1 type of cells and Th2 cells. So they gradually take over. One type of cells finish their work, then the Th2 type of cells take over. So how that happens, that the process of allorecognition is still a big query. But the type of endometrial natural killer cells, when they get converted into a particular type called a CD57, which they can have a CD57 marker. These are the maturated form of CD56 type of cells, which are normally not present in endometrium. And their presence in endometrium is indicative of immunological problem. And second is the role of T regulatory cells. Now that has come up as a big important aspect, and T regulatory cells in the peripheral blood, also T regulatory cells in the endometrium have been studied. To study it, endometrium is difficult, but peripheral blood T-reg cells have been, estimation has been done, and many studies have shown that it is low in patients who are prone to RPL, or during pregnancy, if the T-regulatory cell count falls, then that indicates that pregnancy is failing. And there are immunomodulatory methods, which after giving those particular methods, T-reg cell count increases, which indicates that this particular method is effective in preventing further reproductive failure. So blood cells, blood tests, so there are a lot of tests you must have heard.
So maybe at one point you will be thinking of, instead of in vitro fertilization, you have to go a step ahead and do in vitro implantation tests and see whether it...
I think that will be future. And why not? Because few years back, we never thought about embryo biopsy. So which is now a practical thing. So I think definitely it will come. So it is very important for us to be open about it and think about it. And because one important thing I just want to share with you, that the first thing that we learn about a new subject or new aspect of a disease, we see what are the papers published on that particular subject and how many of them are peer reviewed. And only so when a particular thing is peer reviewed, that means everyone accepts that this is the right thing, and then everyone accepts. But if there is a new thing which comes up, it can't be because it is not possible, because that's how science grows. So it is very important to have an open
mind. I think that's a very valid point that you said, because until everyone uses it or becomes familiar with the concept, that peer review itself is not possible, because you won't have a big enough peer group. So because, maybe
right, because the big say we don't use, so others also don't use, so there are no papers, so automatically nothing is mentioned in guidelines, and it's a negative spiral, and we are happy with it. But someone breaks the shackles, and then the things change.
And I think more and more reporting has to be done by people like you who have more experience in it. Once you start reporting your successes, I think it'll come into that charted territory. Currently, it's very uncharted, and all of us are a little bit in awe of immunotherapy.
Can I say something?
Yes.
Very nice lecture, and actually quite interesting to see. Basically, the lit therapy and all is coming back again. Like as you have mentioned, when I in 1996-97, we used to do endometrial aspiration, look for NK cell activity, and those with unexplained multiple abortions where everything under the sun had been already tried, then this was the last option we had, that go for lit therapy. some of the patients actually did carry the pregnancy. And while we were doing this in our practice, we also got the feedback that this is, you know, of no use. And we found that some of the patients wouldn't respond. So basically, in terms of immunomodulation, anything and everything has been tried. And then when you have done with it, all you do is just counsel the patient, and then without anything and with just fulvite and repeated abortions, also she carries pregnancy to term. So basically, I think this is whole thing going again and again. IVIG, Bhar Globe, Lit Therapy, Duphaston, so many things, and then nothing. So, but very nice lectures.
Last thing I will like to mention what you said the point correctly. See, why certain immunomodulatory treatments work and why they don't in all patients? Because now there is a new concept which has come up, is about the endometrial, exactly immune profiling of endometrium, and which can be profiled as activating or suppressing, increase activation or decrease activation or suppression. So there are immunomodulatory treatments which are activating, like G-CSF. If they are given in an immunological aberration which is activating type, it will not work. While if the certain immunomodulatory medications like IVIG are suppressing, so an activating type of immune aberration will be corrected by using the suppressive type of immunomodulation, that is immunoglobulin. So this differentiation, if once we come to know, then immunomodulation will be more specific. And as Dr. Chinmay asked about the specific subgroups, we can find out. And then it will not be just a random thing to give everyone. And then we give to someone who is where it is not indicated, and then it doesn't work. And the fault goes to the therapy rather than the selection.
I think in the interest of time, we'll probably have to move on. But this is really something which has opened up a huge sort of Pandora's box of thoughts. Because this is something ahead of its time, and only people like you who've gone into that much detail and have understood everything are right now the correct people to use it, because it's still not into common use because we don't understand how we should use it. But you should tell us more and more, and we'll know how to use it. Kiran sir, your comments, and then we'll move on.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Rao. Thank you so much.
Before we move, can I just interfere here? I think Dr. Ragini ma'am has come. Ragini ma'am, are you there? I think she came and left. If ma'am comes again, we'll ask her to say a few
words. We'll ask her to say a few words. Yeah, we'll do.
Yeah, Ashwini, just see if ma'am comes.
Sure.
Dr. Raut, wonderful talk, and especially the selective treatment of immunotherapy, patient selection, how to go about it. It was really very, very informative. So thank you very much. I hand over to the chairperson.
Thank you. Dr. Rath, could you invite Priyanko?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. So it's a real pleasure to invite on stage Dr. Priyanko Roy. He's currently the, I think Ragini ma'am has come. Priyanko, just 1 minute, we'll wait. Ragini ma'am, we've been waiting to listen from you. So before we start, Priyanko, please give us a few words of wisdom.
Discussion, Chinmay, it is such a wonderful discussion is going on. And I have just talked for the... I was not here because I was talking on an RPL. And with the guidelines, I was telling that these things are not recommended. Whatever is being discussed here, that we can give or not give. And thank you so much, Vaishali, for giving me this invitation. And I will not interrupt much because I respect the time of the delegates and the academics. I will just only say, you're all doing a great work. And this RPL is really the day we will solve. It will be a great thing, but it is certain we are not going to solve it. This new thing which Dr. Kamath has said, the suppressing and the activating type of the endometrium, everything we are getting a new thing. Let's continue our discussion. I am also eagerly listening everything. Over to
Surely,
you.
Thank you, Ragini ma'am. Thank you for being here. Thank you. In spite of a webinar going on simultaneously, you agreed and you are here with us. So all this balancing and multitasking that you are doing, thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you.
That is also the immunosuppression and the immunoactivation balancing. So thank you so much, ma'am. And I think Dr. Vaishali has done a great job of bringing everyone together and continuing this really cutting edge academic. She's setting the bar of perinatology very high. So I really have to climb high there. But so now back to Priyankur. Can we have his slide, please? He's one of the most well-known and well-seen faces in current academics in OBG in India, because in almost every webinar, he's either on the scene or behind the scene. So an extremely active worker and a very, very passionate teacher. Dr. Priyankur Roy, he has this array of degrees attached to his names. And he has been the India representative of WATOG in FIGO, Joint Secretary of Gestosis India Chapter, National Coordinator of this Perinatology Committee, the East Zone Coordinator of the Infertility and Endocrinology Committee, FOCSI, Joint Secretary of the Siliguri OBGYN Society, and the Organizing Secretary for the forthcoming East Zone UA FOCSI, for which he's really working day and night. He's a very keen academician, a very good hold on statistics and a lot of things, because we keep referring to him for a lot of our queries with regard to research methodology. And he has been awarded so many awards, as you can see. And I hope, Priyankur, the list becomes longer and longer for you. And one day we should be seeing the entire slide full of awards. So without coming between you and the audience, I would like to invite you to deliver your talk on the review of anti-D immunoglobulin in rhesus-negative pregnancy. That's again another a very enigmatic topic, and we're really waiting to hear what you have to tell us.
Thank you, Chinmay ma'am, for the wonderful introduction. Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, Kiran sir, who have also agreed to be the chairperson for this session. And I would really like to thank Vaishali ma'am, the ever energetic chairperson of our committee, because she has really taken the committee to a much, much greater height. So thank you, ma'am, for that. So after the excellent talk that we just heard from Dr. Raut, sir, I'll be talking over here on role of anti-D immunoglobulin in managing Rh negative pregnancies. So good evening, everyone. So we all know globally, the Basque population of Spain has the highest incidence of Rh negativity, that is almost 30 to 35%. Otherwise, it's 15 to 16% for whites, and it's almost 2% or less in Asians and others. Source of anti-D, it's manufactured from pooled plasma from those with higher titers of IgG antibodies to D-positive erythrocytes. Once produced from the plasma of alloimmunized women, now from male donors who undergo repeated injections of D-positive red cells to produce high titers of antibodies. Scarcity of resources has led to a search for a synthetic anti-D immunoglobulin. Potential future advantages of synthetic product over products derived from humans includes greater availability, elimination of risks of pathogen transmission, and adverse reactions due to impurities in the plasma. So if you look at the pharmacology and the pharmacokinetics, if the dose is 300 micrograms, which contains sufficient amount of anti-D to suppress the immune response to 15 ml of D-positive red cells or 30 ml of D-positive whole cells. So basically, this formula we usually should follow, but then we do not do it much in India because the dosage of 50 micrograms and 100 micrograms is not that very readily available in India. A single 50 microgram dose contains sufficient anti-D to suppress the immune response to 2.5 ml of D-positive red cells, which is the one which is recommended in cases of abortions or early trimester losses. The half-life is almost 24 days. In a small proportion of patients and with highly sensitive assays, as long as 95 days after routine antepartum injection and possibly as long as 180 days, it suffices. So mechanism, it's basically by a significant number of anti-D of D antigen sites on fetal RBCs in the maternal circulation and are not bound by passive anti-D immunoglobulin. The fetal red cells coated by anti-D are rapidly cleared by a macrophage-mediated process and or the downregulation of antigen-specific B cells before an immune response occurs. Efficacy, of course, we know it's efficacious. That's why the anti-D, the isoimmunization chances and the risk have decreased so much nowadays. Without the use of anti-D, it's approximately 16% of D-negative women become alloimmunized after two deliveries of D-positive ABO-incompatible women, ABO-compatible infants. The rate falls to 1 to 2%. So, of course, we can see that's a significant number that the rate falls to. The rate falls to 0.1 to 0.3% with the addition of routine AP administration in the third trimester, that is the antenatal administration, which is ideally done somewhere between 32 to 34 weeks. We can also do the administration at 28 weeks, but as per the recommendation, if the gap between the two doses administered, if it's more than three months, that is, it's more than 10 to 12 weeks, then we should repeat the dose of the postnatal anti-D as well. D-alloisomerization has not been completely eliminated because of failure to administer anti-D in accordance with published guidelines and because of unsuspected fetomaternal bleeding early in gestation before administration of third trimester prophylaxis. So the risks are a risk of fetal anemia, enhancement of fetal primary immune response to D-positive red blood cells, adverse obstetric outcome, reduced maternal response to postpartum rubella immunization, short or long-term harm to fetal immune system, and there is no evidence that maternal administration of anti-D immunoglobulin results in any significant risks. There can be some infections and allergic reactions, especially in plasma units for making anti-D are tested to antibodies of hepatitis C, hepatitis B, HIV, and parvovirus, which definitely needs to be done. Anti-D prepared by this method must be administered only intramuscularly, and anti-D prepared by ion exchange chromatography isolation are purer and can be given intravenously or intramuscularly. But the one we get over here, the corn cold ethanol fractionation is how it's prepared, and this is where we need to give it only intramuscularly. So the general approach, we all know it, the one we need to follow. And all anti-D pregnant women should undergo an antibody screen, ICT, at the first prenatal visit of early pregnancy. The blood test is accurate and inexpensive, of course. If antibodies are identified, she is counseled about continuing pregnancy, utilizing interventions for predicting the risk of hemolytic disease of fetus and newborn, and diagnosing and treating severe fetal anemia. Screen positive women should not receive anti-D because it's not required, because the antibodies are already there and isoimmunization has already happened. Candidate for anti-D immunoglobulin, D negative women for negative ICT and who are pregnant are the candidates for anti-D, ideally 28 weeks of gestation. After delivery, if the newborn is D positive, if the newborn is D negative, then we do not need to give it. In addition, after an antepartum event associated with an increased risk of fetomaternal bleeding, and D negative women who are carrying a D negative fetus does not benefit from anti-D immunoglobulin. Management based on prenatal D typing. If the biological father of the fetus is known with certainty to be D negative, then antenatal anti-D may be omitted. Assurance of paternity in this case is better be documented in the medical record, because a meta-analysis revealed a median incidence of 3% of issues related to paternity. So this was one of the examples I would like to say. In one of the hospitals when I was doing my residency in CMC Vellore, we were in a rural setup. And there it's a routine for nurses to deliver patients basically. So the nurse patient was a D negative patient, and when the patient delivered, the nurse automatically took the blood sample of the baby, and that's a cord blood, and sent it off for blood testing. Later on in the record, when I saw that the blood group, the husband's blood group was D negative, I told her that it was not required, but then anyway, if you have sent it, it's all right. And when the report came, it was positive. So it is probably the case where we see that it's probably the case of this 3% that I was talking to you about. Okay, use of cell-free fetal DNA for fetal D typing in maternal blood, controversial. If cell-free DNA results suggest that the fetus is male and D negative, then antenatal anti-D can be omitted. However, if the fetus is female and D negative, then possibly that the result reflects the maternal rather than the fetal RHD gene. The National Institute of Health in England recommends fetal RHD genotype as a cost-effective option to guide antenatal prophylaxis with anti-D immunoglobulin. An Australian study also concluded that RHD genotyping was an economically sound option. In 2019, a cost analysis available in the United States found that fetal RHD genotyping is not a cost-effective option. There were studies done in Denmark, Netherlands, Sweden, England, France, and Finland, who said fetal RHD determination is performed routinely in D-negative women. The advantages is Over one third of D negative women, when appropriately avoided, antenatal anti-D immunoglobulin could be there. And the disadvantage, of course, is selective approach has to be potential to increase the number of cases of D alloimmunization because of the possibility of a false negative result. So the prophylaxis at 28 weeks of gestation, antibody rescreening at 28 weeks will detect the rare woman who has become alloimmunized in intervals since the first screen. Single dose of 300 micrograms can be administered. UK and Canada, two doses are used, one at 28 weeks and the other at 34 weeks. So now, recently, there has been a study which said that we can administer somewhere between 30 to 32 weeks as well, if it's a low resource setting, and if we think that if it's a case of a preterm labor where the lady might deliver within 6 to 8 or 8 to 10 weeks, then it's not required to deliver to probably give the postnatal if it's a cost is an issue. A network of meta-analysis found that two doses at 28 to 34 weeks regimen of 300 micrograms were more effective than a single dose of 300 micrograms at 28 weeks for reducing the incidence of alloimmunization. Additional cover, the D antigen is detectable on embryonic cells by 38 days after conception. Some groups do not recommend prophylactic anti-D if it is a complete spontaneous miscarriage before 12 weeks of gestation. Spontaneous versus induced abortion before 20 weeks have been associated with a 1.5 to 2% and a 4 to 5% risk of alloimmunization respectively. So for invasive procedures, the additional procedures we need to cover up are CVS, amniocentesis, amnioinfusion, fetal blood sampling, fetoscopy, fetoscopic surgery, and multifetal reduction. That is any chance of any maternofetal transfusion or maternofetal bleed or maternofetal any chance of any leak, there we need to give the RH isoimmunization. We also need to give it for blunt abdominal trauma and external cephalic version in case of ectopic pregnancy, threatened abortion, as well as antepartum bleeding in the second and third trimester, where it has to be a dose of 300 micrograms theoretically as well. Fetal death in the second or third trimester can be an alloimmunizing event when caused by massive fetomaternal hemorrhage or occult abruption should be given in cases of hydatidiform mole as well. But we need to remember here, a complete mole does not contain fetal red cells, but prophylaxis after evacuation is suggested in partial molar pregnancies. So complete mole, it is not required. Dose 50 microgram would be enough. Remember, in the first trimester, that is, remember, there is no harm in giving the standard 300 micrograms, and we do give it because of the availability. Second and third trimester, as I've already mentioned, if it's IUD or whatever it is, the doses has to be 300 micrograms that has to be given. Recommendation is to monitor the maternal ICT every 3 weeks in women with recurrent antepartum bleeding who have received prophylaxis. If the result is positive, indicating that anti-D immune globulin from the previous dose of prophylaxis is still present, no additional treatment is necessary. If the result is negative, then the woman may not be protected. In this case, a test to evaluate the volume of fetal red blood cells in the maternal circulation is obtained, and a repeat dose of 300 micrograms of anti-D immune globulin is administered. So how do you test? The incidence of a large fetomaternal bleed is approximately 1 in 200 to 300 deliveries. These are beyond the limit covered by a single 300 micrograms of anti-D. The Rosette test is of course suggested as an initial test. It is a qualitative yet sensitive test to diagnose a fetomaternal bleeding or the amount of fetomaternal bleeding. A standard dose of anti-D is given to patients with a negative test when the amount of fetomaternal bleeding is smaller than 2 ml or that is 0.04% of fetal red cells in maternal blood. When the Rosette test is positive, a clear bed kit test or a flow cytometry is recommended to determine the percentage of fetal red blood cells. So quick recap before I finish. All D negative pregnant women should undergo an anti-D screen at the first prenatal visit. If the initial screen is negative, a repeat screen at 28 weeks of gestation prior to the administration of anti-D. For pregnant women who are D negative, routine administration of anti-D immunoglobulin early in the third trimester for optimum dose is ideally 300 micrograms at 28 to 30 weeks of gestation. Administration of antenatal anti-D is needed when there is an increased risk of fetomaternal bleeding. Testing for quantifying the fetomaternal bleed is better done for events after 20 weeks. Repeat doses of those who repeated bleeding episodes better be decided by results of ICT after 3 weeks. Administration of anti-D within 72 hours of delivery of an D positive infant is recommended. Okay, let me just come to this 72 hours giving the dose. So the protocol came basically, it is one of the first line that is mentioned in the Williams textbook. And basically the protocol came from the fact that in England, in those days of the world war, the prison hospital used to be closed on Saturdays and Sundays. So the rule of 72 hours was because in case a patient delivers on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you can't take it. So you have to take it by Monday. And that has become sort of a standard rule for us. But please do remember, if a patient hasn't taken it within 72 hours also, do not, it should not be a fact that you are not giving it. We can give it up to any point of time, but then 72 hours is ideally recommended. And also we discharge a patient within 72 hours, so it's best to give it by then. If missed out, give as soon as it is remembered. Partial protection is afforded within 13 days of birth and maybe an effect as late as 28 days of birth. So this is just a flowchart of whatever I have mentioned now. So I will not go through it again. So thank you for the patient listening. And I hope my talk will have some value addition to your day-to-day practice. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Priyankur. I think quite a number of points that you mentioned were very crystal clear and don't need that much of clarification. One of the issues also, I think you should add in the entity is whenever it is administered, it should be administered in the deltoid as opposed to gluteal, although it's an intramuscular injection. And that makes a lot of difference in the absorption of the immunoglobulin and its effect. So that is something, let us all of us remember that. And like he said, if we forget to give it postnatally within 72 hours, up to 28 days is also okay. It's acceptable. The best is to give early. A few audience questions are there. Can a rhesus positive mother and father have a rhesus negative child?
I would say yes, because yes. I'm an example of that. My positive and I'm A negative. So yeah.
It's positive. So if your parents are rhesus positive and you're rhesus negative, that means both your parents are heterozygous. Yes. And you happen to be a combination of the negative-negative gene for both of them. So that is possible. What is the role of anti-D in prophylaxis? I think that is the summary of your lecture. You've kind of given that answer. And what is the role of prophylactic dose of anti-D in primi gravida? So there is, isn't it? Would you say you agree with it?
The primi gravida, because the thing is, we are of course in the next pregnancy, we are trying to prevent obviously the any sort of isoimmunization happening in the mother, so that in the next pregnancy also it doesn't carry forward. One point that I missed out, I think, in the presentation is, in case if a mother who has delivered, undergone a cesarean section or a normal delivery and even has gone for a tubal ligation, we should give an anti-D to this mother, because it prevents the risk in case we are giving any future blood transfusions, or in the if a patient has any RTA, etc., where patient requires blood transfusion. So that sort of isoimmunization reactions can also be prevented.
And she might want later on, she might change her mind about having another baby, isn't it? So that's one thing. The other thing, what you were just saying, in primi gravida, I think what the question is, the role of a prophylactic dose in primi gravida. Do we routinely advise for antenatal anti-D in primi gravida? We do, because a lot of isoimmunization can happen in the third trimester of any pregnancy because of fetal maternal bleed. So even a primi gravida is at risk of that kind of antenatal bleed. So it's a good practice to give it antenatally. The bodies which restrict the use of anti-D is because they think it's a human product, and you know, we have to limit. That is why all the studies which he showed at different places where they wanted the fetal genotyping so that you could restrict the use, because we don't want to overtly use this and overuse the anti-D. But given our circumstances, it is always better. Only today we did a third transfusion for a woman who's highly positive for anti-D antibodies, and that's a really, really sad situation to be in. So in this circumstance, prevention is always better than cure.
Especially in this scenario, when anti-D is available, it doesn't make sense, and all this testing, etc., a patient, even if you say, might not come back and follow up with you and might not show you the report, and you might end up missing it, and ultimately the lady will go for a
testing is not straightforward. I mean, we deal with these genetic tests every day, but we are also struggling, because to do a proper genotyping, you need a fetal sample. And if that is obtained by invasive method, the whole purpose is counterintuitive. So there is no thing like that. So Kiran, sir, any comments? Sir, unmute yourself, please.
You have summed it up everything. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I will just like to say one thing that very, very common in our side of places, that the girls have become very smart. Those who are sexually active, they will go for medical termination of pregnancy without knowing their blood group. And that's the time they will be actually not taking anti-D. So half-baked information. And invariably, we'll find in our pregnant patient also, those who have history of abortion, they will be the ones where she will turn out to be Rh negative. She hasn't taken an NTD.
So I think the lesson that what your point makes is that any Rh negative woman that you see in your antenatal clinic for the first time, please do an ICT, an indirect
definitely.
So that is whether primary gravida or for so-called primary gravida, please do an ICT at booking. So
awareness about Rh factor should actually be very widespread, because now people are using all the empty pills and not bothered about their blood group.
And all the more reason, because the thing is, this NTD is so commonly available now, and doesn't make sense of pushing our patient getting into such an issue because she hasn't taken it or she was not aware of it. So definitely, as Mama said, ICT for the first visit of so-called primary gravida or whatever pregnancy, we definitely should do it, and we should carry forward from there.
So thank you very much, Priyankar, for that lovely talk. And thank you, Dr. Vaishali, for this opportunity of being part of this wonderful session. Thank you, Kiran sir, for being the co-chair here. And I think we'll hand over to Dr. Ashwini. Sure.
Yeah. If I can just say a few words.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you, Priyankar. Wonderful talk. I think you've covered most of the things. So when we have a panel discussion next, we will elaborate on these points more as clinical scenario, case-based discussion we are going to have. But wonderful talk. You've covered everything.
So, sorry, ma'am, for the opportunity, and Chinmay ma'am and Kiran sir for chairing the session. Thank you.
And thank you to Dr. Kiran. He is our walking, talking encyclopedia of Pune Obstetric Gynec Society. And he is absolutely brilliant. You ask him anything, anytime, day, night, middle of the night. He will just rattle off all the information, and he's the one who inspires us. And because of people like him in Pune OBGY Society, we have come on the FOXI platform. Thank you, Kiran, for being here today. It means a lot.
I'm flattered.
And thank you, dear Chinmay. It was wonderful to hear you speak. You always do speak well. I have listened to a lot of your lectures and talks. So wonderful to hear you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much,
Chairpersons. We move on to our next session, which is the panel discussion. May I have the CV of Vaishali, madam, please? Dr. Vaishali Chavan, madam, is currently the chairperson of FOXI Perinatology Committee. As we all know, she is the director at Sahyadri Super Speciality Hospitals in Pune and the Sanvi Clinic. She's also been the postgraduate teacher. She was the executive vice president of Pune OBGY Society during the year 2019, and she's got many national and international publications to her credit. She was awarded the Punya Bhushan Award in 2017, the Samaj Bhushan Award, and the Vaidya Gaurav Puraskar in 2017, the Lokmata Award in the same year. She was also awarded the Inspiring Gynecologist of West India Award by the Economic Times and Times of India in the year 2019. And she's always made Pune OBGY Society very proud, and she's etched a name for herself in the map of India. So over to you, Vaishali madam, for the panel on Rh negative.
Thank you, dear Ashwini, for such a kind introduction. And now I would like to welcome our panelists. Let me welcome Dr. Mitra Saxena. Ma'am is, as we know, she's chairperson-elect Practical Obstetrics Committee FOXI 21-23. A senior consultant OPGY at Reverie, Haryana, and she's been active in FOXI since last 20 years. She was North Zone Coordinator Ethics Medical Legal Committee, North Zone Coordinator Breast Committee. She was past president Reverie OBGY Society. She was project director Mukti and initiative of Haryana.
I think OBGY Dr. Vaishali, please carry on. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So ma'am is truly an academician and a very skilled speaker. I would like to invite our next panelist. Next slide, please. Yeah, Dr. Ritu Khanna. Thank you, Dr. Ritu, for being here. She is chairperson-elect FOXI, Food and Drug Medical Surgical Equipment Committee. She is Secretary, Society of Fetal Medicine, UP Chapter, Vice Chairperson, Women Doctors Wing, IMA Banaras Branch, and Joint Treasurer, Indian Fertility Society, 2018-20. And she has been working on exclusive single embryo transfer. She has been awarded many awards and publications, and her field of interest is laparoscopic, hysteroscopic fertility enhancing surgeries.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Vaishali.
Our third panelist today is, can you change the slide, please? Yeah, Dr. Selva Priya Saravanan, dear friend. Thank you, Selva, you're here. I think you have some problem with the net.
Hi, Vaishali, and hi, everybody. Hello, madam.
So Selva is a very well-known fetal medicine expert. She's director of Spring Fertility Feto Care Fetogene. She's the clinical director of NDGH GIFT Fertility and Fetal Medicine Center. She's secretary of Nagarkoil OBGY Society 2021 and 23, and very, very active worker, very active, enthusiastic FOCSI worker and a figure in to reckon in FOCSI. Welcome, Selva. I would also like to welcome Dr. Sarina Gilwaz. Is madam there? Yes, ma'am. Madam, thank you for accepting and for being here today. Madam is Professor in HOD OBGY Department, Jubilee Mission Medical College and Hospital. And she has done her post-graduation from Madurai Medical College. Her fields of interest are high-risk obstetrics and laparoscopic surgery and, of course, teaching. And ma'am has been in postgraduate teaching right from 1994. And she has received innumerable awards. Ma'am, welcome.
Thank you.
I would now like to welcome dear Ashwini Kare. She is from our parent society of Pune. And Ashwini is IVF consultant and chief embryologist, Asha Kiran Hospital, Asha IVF Center. She was general secretary of Pune OBGY Society 20 and 21, where she has done revolutionary work, in fact, path-breaking work with the amount of programs that she has done with President Dr. Harshad Parasnis. And hybrid conference, first of its kind, was done, national, international conferences, lot of publications. So wonderful, dynamic personality. She is chairperson AMOG's YTP committee 2020 and 22, treasurer Maharashtra chapter ISAR. She's zonal coordinator of AMOX and ex-assistant professor, BJ Medical College, Pune. Welcome, dear Ashwini. So I would like to share my screen. Is my screen?
No, ma'am, not yet.
Yeah. All right. Is my screen seen?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So, as we know, Rh negative pregnancy in very earlier days, in our post-graduation days, we used to see babies who had been severely affected. But then, nowadays, it's such kind of babies and hemolytic affection of the babies has much less reduced, maybe with the advent of, easy advent of anti-D immunoglobulin. So, this panel discussion is going to be very clinical and case-based and with very clear take-home messages for our delegates and people who are listening about anti-D immunoglobulin, when to give, when not to give, what are the clear-cut indication, what are the ultrasound, when it needs to be done, what are the Doppler values, and do you really need to assess fetomaternal hemorrhage, how to go about it, and such things. So as clinicians, we ideally need to know whether the patient coming to you, is she immunized or she is non-immunized. If she is immunized, the treatment changes. It's a different pathway. And if she is non-immunized, then it is a primary responsibility to prevent immunization, that this patient shouldn't go into isoimmunization, and what are the preventive steps that we should take. So proceeding to the first question, Mitra ma'am, can I ask you this question? Gravida 2, para 1, living 1, 10 weeks pregnancy. B Rh negative blood group has come for routine antenatal registration. So what would be your clinical approach, and is the patient's past history relevant? Would you like to do husband's blood group, or, you know, how relevant is the past obstetric history?
Thank you, Dr. Vaishali, to have me there on this panel. And without much ado, let's come to answering this question. So whenever we are confronted with a pregnant lady who's already had a delivery and now she's pregnant again, and the information we have is that she's BRH negative. So what is extremely important is to know what was the blood group of the previous baby, did she receive anti-D, and what's the blood group of the husband. Because we know very well, if the mother is RH negative and the husband is also RH negative, the chances that the baby is going to be RH negative only is automatically there. So the story of RH finishes there and then. But if the baby is RH positive and the husband is RH positive and patient has received anti-D, we expect that she wouldn't be isoimmunized. However, we would still like to know now what is going to be the course in the present pregnancy. So my first thing would be, after knowing what was the type of labor, did she receive any antepartum anti-D prophylaxis, did she receive postpartum prophylaxis, what are the blood group of the baby, etc., etc., I would like to know what's the blood group of the husband. And two things in the blood group of the husband, as important as the RH is also the ABO blood group. If the mother is B negative and the husband is also B, we expect that if it is ABO incompatibility, then we expect lesser of RH isoimmunization, because a non-compatible blood group RBC of the husband would be finished off earlier. So it is not just importance of seeing the RH factor of the husband, also to know the blood group of the husband is important also. Then when we know the whether the husband is RH positive, we should make an effort if we can to find out the zygosity of the husband's blood group. Because if it is homozygous, we can expect that the baby will be RH positive. And if it is heterozygous, then of course, there is a possibility that this pregnancy may be an RH negative. In which case, if we have the facility to find out the fetal blood group, that can be used so that we can do away with antenatal prophylaxis if the baby is RH negative. So actually, to summarize the whole thing, it's very important to take a detailed history of previous pregnancy and its outcome. And in the present pregnancy, what is the blood group of the husband? And basically, this is the time to give the patient and the husband a complete scenario of what will happen once we have all the reports there. And of course, if my husband was RH positive and the mother is, the possibility of immune, this RH disease is there, we have to also do the ICT and complete, you know, routine tests.
Right. Very rightly said, ma'am. And especially if in the past pregnancy there has been neonatal affection like icterus or eye drops or anemia, then probably in this pregnancy, the same neonatal or fetal affection is going to happen probably 2 weeks earlier. So the history regarding the neonate is also very important. Very nicely summed up, ma'am. You also mentioned about ICT. So can anybody just enumerate about ICT and when ideally it should be done? For this patient, which is a Gravida 2 para 1, and not only for this patient, even for any primary Gravida or any patient who walks into your OPD, pregnant patient, when would you like to do ICT?
I'll take up, Vishali.
Yes, of course. Yes.
So now if she is a first pregnancy, then we do it at the first visit that she comes to us, and then at 22, 24 and 28 weeks. And if she is a subsequent pregnancy, then we look into the previous pregnancy, a previous pregnancy which has got no or a mild hemolytic disease, then you do it at the first booking. And every 4 to 6 weeks, you go on repeating. In case you get an ICT positive, then you stop with this thing and you go in for the antibody titer. And if she has a previous pregnancy with a severe hemolytic disease, then we don't need to do the titer anymore. And then you test for the fetal anemia from the 16 to 18 weeks.
So, that's rightly said. So, every patient who walks in needs ICT to be done primarily at the first visit itself, because this is a test which is going to tell us whether this patient is immunized or non-immunized. If she is immunized, then the treatment changes. We have to look out for fetal anemia, and you have to really do intense surveillance for this patient. And if she is non-immunized, then you have to, like Dr. Ritu said, you have to keep repeating the ICT. So there are two thoughts here. Initially, they said that you should repeat ICT at 12 weeks. If it's negative, then for a primary, you should keep repeating at 20, 28 weeks, 32 till delivery. And for a multi, if she's negative at 12 weeks, you repeat every 4 weeks.
But the second thought train of thought is the need of 4 weekly antibody screening in non-immunized Rh negative women is, especially in primary gravida, is not really accepted, because Rh isoimmunization rarely happens during the antenatal period, and first pregnancy usually severe isoimmunization and the fetal affection, fetal hemolytic disease is not seen. But to be on the safe side, it is better to repeat ICT regularly.
Vaishali, so can I add a sentence?
Yes, please.
Yeah. See, now we must also know why this is called an indirect womb specific.
Ma'am,
Salina, don't hear me.
Salina, ma'am, we can't see you.
The video.
Oh, you can't, is it? Okay. Wait one, just a sec. Can you see me now?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Fine. Yeah. So I'll just tell you a few things which all of us must understand about Rh. One thing is that between the mother and the baby, there is a wall which is not being breached. It is a complete wall. In other words, the mother's blood doesn't mix with the fetal blood, and the fetal blood normally doesn't mix with the maternal blood. So whenever we say the baby has got a fetomaternal hemorrhage, what we really mean is the mother is Rh negative and the baby is Rh positive, and there is some leak by which the fetal blood has entered the maternal circulation. And we say the mother is immunized when we say that she has started developing antibodies. Okay. So once the mother has started developing antibodies, we say the mother is immunized. And it is these antibodies which go back to the fetus and produce hemolysis and anemia in the fetus. Now, we want to know whether the mother is positive or not, and it is ICT positive. So what it is called indirect, because we add Rh positive cells to the maternal serum, and then we see whether the antibodies have coated over it. We wash that serum so that all the unattached proteins are removed. And if you see coagulation, we see the highest dilution of coagulation. And that is why it is called as ICT. And we take the cutoff in Rh as 1 in 8. So when we say the mother is ICT positive, that means she started producing antibodies and she is immunized. And at any time, she can produce isoimmunization, because these antibodies can go back to the fetus and produce anemia in the fetus.
So the question here, ma'am, is how frequently would you like to do ICT? Dr. Ritu has already mentioned.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah. So like ma'am said, it is actually the hemorrhage that occurs. The mother's blood cells cross over to the fetal circulation, and the maternal antigen evokes the immunological response, and the antibody which is formed, it coats the fetal RBCs, and then it destroys the fetal RBCs, and this is known as the hemolysis which occurs. And the hemolytic disease of the fetus and the newborn is proportionate to the damage of the fetal RBCs. So that is why to diagnose this we do ICT. So now coming to what are the fetal hemolytic diseases for the fetus and newborn, if you can just enumerate.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, of course.
So when we talk about fetal affection, hemolytic disease, what we mean is the conditions where the red blood cells of the fetus is going to be affected and the life is shortened. So when the life of the red blood cells, the fetal red blood cells is shortened, we are going to land up in varying degrees of jaundice, hepatosplenomegaly, hydrops and anemia. So mainly here we can categorize them as Rh oriented, which is immune to anti-D alone, or it may be with other Rh antibodies like anti-C, small c, capital C, E and E. Or it can be ABO, or it can be the other ones which we think as the unexpected immune antibodies other than anti-D, like all this JKK and FY. So mainly here what we are dealing with is the hydrops, the neonatal micturus gravis and the severe anemia of the newborn. So this will be the fetal affection pattern.
Yeah, rightly said, Selva. So coming to the fourth question, Ashwini, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
So there are a lot of procedures, and we try, to avoid these procedures, because certain procedures are there which increase the risk of fetomaternal hemorrhage. So can you just enumerate these procedures?
Actually, if we see them trimester wise, so beginning right from the first trimester,
there is all kinds of abortions, whether it is spontaneous, painless, induced abortions, even medical termination of pregnancy, which is very common. Then there's cordocentesis. Then in the second trimester, there are procedures like amniocentesis, even ruptured ectopic pregnancy, like vesicular mole. All of these induce fetomaternal hemorrhage. Coming to the later trimester, there are episodes of PPROM, then even external cephalic version, which we don't do nowadays, but then there are still some peripheral centers which do it. So even the attempt to do an ECV actually induces fetomaternal hemorrhage. Then there's vaginal delivery, cesarean section, manual removal of placenta. So all of these abruptio placenta, any blunt trauma, even IUDs, these are the things which introduce the fetomaternal hemorrhage.
Yeah, so like Ashwini said, you know, we need to be aware about these procedures because these patients need to be covered with intervention. So that is the reason we need to be aware about these sensitizing events in pregnancy. Coming to the main topic, like the clear-cut take-home messages we are going to give about anti-D immunoglobulin. And we are going to talk about our AADP, that is the routine antenatal anti-D prophylaxis and the correct doses. So coming to the clinical case scenario, so we'll go through. Yes, Mitra ma'am, you want to say something?
No, I was going to say about this only. The same question has come, I was going to mention this only.
Okay, so we'll just quickly go through different case scenarios. Yeah. So coming to you, Mitra ma'am, primary with 6 weeks of pregnancy, she's BRH negative. And she's undergone spontaneous abortion. So do you think there's a need to give anti-D?
Yeah. So what we have to remember is that in the fetal development, embryo development, as early as 38th day, the fetal RBCs are already there. So which means that once there is fetal RBCs are made, so there is a possibility of fetal maternal hemorrhage. So early pregnancy, 6 weeks, whether it is abortion or an ectopic, any disturbance of very early pregnancy deserves to be covered for anti-D because there is a possibility of isoimmunization. So, yes, definitely.
Any difference of opinion from our panelists, anyone wants to differ or add anything?
No, there is a school of thought which says that if you don't do anything invasive, when it is a spontaneous thing, you don't have to give. But I too would think what Dr. Mitra said is right. It is better to give rather than not give.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
All the dose that you need give is just 50 micrograms. So
actually, ma'am, we don't have 50 micrograms.
Yeah. We have 100 here. We have 100, but we don't have 50.
So 100 is the optimal dose.
Vishali, yeah. There's another school of thought which says spontaneous, don't give. But if there are contractions or this, then you give. But still, we agree that yes, we should because Manpour mentioned in his talk, spontaneous versus induced abortion, anything before 20 weeks is associated with 1.5 to 2% in spontaneous and 4 to 5 in induced. So I think we should give this dose.
Yeah. We should. So I think everyone agrees that though there are two schools of thought and one says that, you know, if it's spontaneous, don't give. But the message here is even if it's 6 weeks and spontaneous, please give benefit to this patient and give.
See, actually, if you want to.
Ma'am, you are on mute.
And one more thing, Vaishali, we have already agreed that doing the ICT, the first visit is important. If we are agreeing to that point, then we should be also definitely be okay to give the anti-D even if it is a spontaneous abortion.
See, actually, we want to go into extreme, in-depth. The amount of fetal cell that would have gone at this is very less and may not be sufficient to create an isoimmunization. But this is, we are giving abundant caution
as a protection.
Anti-D. So we are giving benefit.
Benefit. They would have destroyed before they can cite an immune response. So actually we can, it's better to do
empirically. But the message we give here is yes.
Yeah, we have to give. Yeah, that is the message.
And 50 is what is recommended, but we don't get 50 microgram. Here in our hospital, we get 150 microgram. But 50 is what is recommended. So coming to the next question, Gravida 2 para 1 living 1, 7 weeks with ruptured ectopic and has undergone surgical intervention. Will you give a dose?
Yes, I think, madam, since it's a first trimester and a ruptured ectopic, definitely yes for an anti-D. And the dose, as you said, is 150 microgram. Though evidence says give 50 or 100, but we still give 150.
Yes, Ashwini. So they have said like in less than 12 weeks of pregnancy, anti-D prophylaxis is indicated with all these enumerated ectopic, molar, surgical MTPs. And minimum dose of 50 is what we can give. And like in the earlier talk, Priyankur said, within 72 hours or as early as possible. Now, the next case is, this is Gravida 3 para 1 A1 living one with 18 weeks of pregnancy, undergone incomplete abortion, and she's undergone surgical intervention. So here, what is the dose of anti-D immunoglobulin? Would you like to give?
With this patient, since she's had an abortion earlier also, I think we would like to do an ICT also because of the previous loss. And if that's negative, we would like to give her 150 micrograms. And the mid-trimester abortions, ICT, we must do and give. You can even give 300 because 300. The amount of antibody neutralization is really not known. So you, if you give a higher dose, there's no harm. So,
that is Dr. Mithu says 300. Mitra ma'am, what would you... say, what would all panelists say?
We would give 300.
Anybody differs?
And I might still think till 20 weeks, 150 would be enough is what I would.
So, again, there are two thoughts, but practically what would you do? Would you give 150 or would you give 300? So, okay, so Ashwini says 150 and if you ask me, I will give 300.
300.
And give 300 because we would like to err on the side of caution because we are not actually measuring the fetal-maternal hemorrhage. We want to cover...
The rule here is whenever you are giving anti-D, you have to do ICT. Without doing ICT, you should not be giving anti-D. And post-delivery, you apart from baby's blood group, you need to do DCT post-delivery before you give anti-D. So, ICT is a must for each and every patient. Because if ICT is positive, what does it mean? It means she is immunized. This anti-D is not going to help. So now coming to the second part of this question, this primary gravida, 16 weeks of pregnancy, she has recurrent episodes of bleeding. So how will you manage? What will you do? It's about anti-D.
Yes, so I can go on. If she has got 3 to 4 episodes of bleeding, ICT is negative. We've given her an anti-D and we can just wait up to around 6 weeks and watch. If the bleeding stops, that's just fine. And if the bleeding doesn't stop and we've given an anti-D, that we need to see, look into the fetal maternal hemorrhage because we need not repeat the dose of 300 before 6 weeks. So after around 3 weeks, you look into the fetal maternal hemorrhage. If it's not much, then this would, if it has stopped and it's not much, this was covered. If it continues, then you need to repeat the dose after 6 weeks.
Yeah, I'm very glad, Dr. Ritu, that you spoke about fetal maternal hemorrhage. So what do the panelists say? How much is the role of estimation of fetal maternal hemorrhage before 20 weeks and after 20 weeks? Where is it more significant?
It's more concerned after 20 weeks rather than before 20 weeks.
Yeah. So ideally before 20 weeks, we avoid doing fetal maternal hemorrhage because it's a smaller pregnancy and the blood fetal maternal hemorrhage is going to be much less. So we try to avoid. Once she crosses 20 weeks, yes, you can assess. And if there's recurrent episodes of bleeding, then this patient may be given a repeat dose of anti-D immunoglobulin if the bleeding persists, like Dr. Ritu said. Now, coming to the third case, in case of IUD, when will you give anti-D? Will you give anti-D or no?
I think yes, as soon as you diagnose the IUD rather IUD. Than waiting for the delivery of the IUD.
Yeah.
Yes. It's like the same as we have for the delivery. Within 72 hours, we need to give the anti-D 300 micrograms.
Right. So the guidelines here say in the event of IUD, where no sample can be obtained from the baby, appropriate dose has to be administered within 72 hours. And here previously non-sensitized women means you have to do an ICT and ICT is negative, then only you can give. Within 72 hours of diagnosis of IUD, irrespective of the time of subsequent delivery.
So here is another guideline which says test for preto maternal hemorrhage should be carried out for all entity Rh negative pregnancy previously non-sensitized event after 20 weeks of, this is RCOG guideline, this needs to be done after 20 weeks of pregnancy. So now routine antenatal dose of anti-D immunoglobulin, there's a what do you prefer, single dose or double dose, at what gestational age, and how much is the dose? Serena ma'am, can you?
Yeah. At 28 weeks, we actually, if the person is negative, the first shot we normally give in uneventful pregnancies at 28 weeks. And then we normally repeat only at term. But there are people who say you can give one more shot at 34 and then repeat at term. But what we do is after 28, then only at term, after birth.
Yeah. Anybody is giving double a dose?
Actually, double dose, they give lesser dose. So we are giving 300 microgram at 28 weeks, and that should be enough. Yeah. And after delivery, when the baby's blood group is there, we follow it up with the second dose.
Especially even the meta-analysis of the studies have revealed, you know, that the administration of one dose, that's 300, and the two doses is almost got a similar effect. And NICE guidelines do agree that you give a single dose. I think we are also following the single dose at 28 weeks.
Actually, it takes economical also, no? In our place, a single injection costs around 2000 plus. So if you give two injections and you actually don't know the blood group of the baby. So, you know, a single dose gives as good a cover. So I think single dose is...
And then our patient may not follow up for the second dose. Better to give at 28 weeks.
Yes.
If using, this is what it said. Post-delivery immunoglobulin dose, how much and... How would you go about
a post delivery? We give 300 micrograms within 72 hours, and of course, if suppose this deadline has not been able to be met, then you can even give it up to some 10 days or even extend up to 28 days. The best is 72 hours. But yes, you could, because just to get a partial effect. And if you have a doubt of a larger placenta or a larger bleed or something, then you, of course, do a fetomaternal hemorrhage estimation and calculate your doses.
Absolutely right. And the injection ideally should be given in deltoid muscle.
Yeah.
Because when you give in gluteal, it reaches just the subcutaneous tissue. Absorption is delayed. Now, Dr. Ritu, you have been talking about fetomaternal hemorrhage. So here is you have said, similar case here, Gravida 3, Para 1, Living 1, 34 weeks of pregnancy with blood pressure 160-100 millimeters of mercury, diagnosed as abrupt show and has undergone emergency section. She had half liter retroplacental clot was retrieved, and fetomaternal hemorrhage here is suspected to be quite extensive. So how do we manage? Manage means regarding the Rh isoimmunization. What are the tests to assess fetomaternal hemorrhage?
So since she's had a large fetomaternal hemorrhage, the first we need to do the qualitative analysis, and that's we do the Rosett test. The maternal blood is mixed with the NTD reagent. The D positive indicator red cells are added, and you know they form the rosettes. And if you get a clumping, which is say less than 3 clumps, then that means that the fetomaternal hemorrhage is not much. It's less than 15 ml of the fetal RBCs, and therefore it will be covered by a single 300 micrograms of anti-D. Now, if the clumps are more than 3 plus, then that means that it's huge and we need to do a quantitative analysis. And that's we do by the Claire Babatke test. And we know that the fetal set will retain the red color because the HbF is resistant to the acid dilution. And so they appear dark pink colored. We count the fetal cells in 200 and you divide it by the RBCs and you multiply it by 1.7, and there's you get the vials of 300 micrograms. Now, if you get into decimals, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, you take them as whole numbers. And if your lab, suppose, is not able to do a KB test, then you need to be on a safer side to take an extra dose. And you calculate, but there's a limit to how many vials you can give.
Yeah.
You know? So if more than 5 is the 5 is the maximum that you can give in 24 hours, at 2 ampules, 8 hourly IV you give. And if you're extra vials, then you need to extend into the next 24 hours.
Okay. Right.
Actually, there is another one more formula for the Kleihauer-Betke's test.
Yeah.
They say that 80 fetal cells in 50 low power field is equivalent to 4 ml of fetal maternal hemorrhage. And right. that is neutralized by 100 micrograms of anti-D. So the 300 micrograms actually neutralizes only about 12 ml of fetal maternal hemorrhage.
Right. So is anybody doing Kleihauer-Betke test in their setup?
No, we don't do it.
I think, yeah. So there's flow cytometry, rosetting, yes. but somehow we don't have access to it.
Yeah.
Kleihauer-Betke is easy to do. There's a formula also. This is a formula which we can assess the excess of fetal maternal hemorrhage. But like Dr. Ritu said, if you suspect there's large hemorrhage, then better to give an additional dose. An additional of as high as 1500 microgram can be given. But when you have to give high dose of anti-D, then there are two preparation, injectable and intravenous. So when a higher dose needs to be given, you will need to give intravenous preparation. Same thing regarding intermittent uterine bleeding. If the bleeding persists, continues, then it is better to assess by the fetal maternal hemorrhage by this test. Now, coming to the next question. This is a Gravida 2. Selva, this is for you. You are the fetal medicine expert. So, Gravida 3, Para 1, A1, L1, 20 weeks pregnancy with ICT titer is 1:32. So this is isoimmunized pregnancy. So I want you to explain to us regarding the role of USG imaging, Doppler values, we say middle cerebral artery, PSV, if it's more than 1.5 mom, then it is significant. So how is it, why is it significant? How will you go about this?
Especially to start with, I'll take the key words from the scenario you've given. Because it's 20 weeks, second word is the ICT titer, 1:30.
You're not audible, Selva. Speak a little loudly.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
There are three catchwords. The gestation age 20 weeks, the ICT titer being 1:32, and the PSV of MCA being 1.5. So 1:32 means I'm bothered. 1:8 to 1:16 is not really significant, but 1:32 means I'm really bothered. And the first thing which strikes me is doing an amniocentesis and analyzing the optical densitometry with the spectrometer. And then the next thing of value is the middle cerebral artery PSV of more than 1.5 mom. Usually, if it is less than 1.5, we would not be bothered. We would wait for the pregnancy to go till 37 weeks and we will not be bothered. But once it is touching that 1.5, it means there is a compromise, there is autoregulation. And in that case, we will split as, 32, less than 32 and more than 32. But here, it is again 20 weeks. Again, the role of USG. Here we are, instead of, ultimately it's going to be fetal anemia and you're going to see all the features, all the Buddha sign, the halo sign. You're going to see ascites, you're going to see high drops and hepatosplenomegaly. But USG and the whole entire treatment and management will be very easy only before these symptoms come into vision in the USG. That is why the titer and PSV is becoming very, very important for us to decide if there is a role of any intrauterine transfusion to the baby. Once the features start coming in the USG, the baby is already in a major compromise in a non-rectifiable condition. So the trick is to catch before the onset of frank ultrasound findings, when the features are subtle, when the MCA PSV is just trying to breach, like how madam said, I like the word breach, more than 1.5 mom, and the titer should be less. That is the crucial area where you decide whether this baby can survive this assault or it will not be able to take the pressure. And that is also a stage where the parents can also decide whether they are going to really make an effort to. 20 weeks is very crucial. I'm talking for this patient. Because every 2 weeks, you will have to keep repeating the test and seeing if the baby is improving or not. So it becomes extremely important to catch the baby right at this point where the titer is 1:32 and when the value is 1.5. This is the right time for intrauterine, making a call on intrauterine transfusions, Vaishali.
Can I just add on? Okay. Yeah, the ideal time to do the peak systolic velocity of the middle cerebral artery would be between 18 and 35 weeks of pregnancy. Because it is said that during this time, we get the accurate values, the sensitivity is also more. After 35 weeks, the false positivity rate increases. Up till 35, it's only about 12% the false positivity rate. So there are two conditions in which you cannot do it. One is after repeated intrauterine transfusions, and after 35 weeks, the false positivity increases. So it is best that we make use of this between 18 and 35 weeks. So after you've given one transfusion, probably we can wait. There'll be little erythropoietic suppression of the fetus. And then you can repeat the transfusion after about another 2 or 3 weeks. And then take it as far as 34 weeks, wait for 2 more weeks, and then deliver the baby.
Right.
And then if required, give top-up transfusions to the baby if anemic.
Exactly. So an RHCP MCA PSV at 18 weeks is extremely, your target TFA scan is extremely important to take any call on that.
Right. So this is the point where you need to involve the fetal medicine expert, because when the titer has reached the critical level or beyond that, or the ultrasound Doppler findings suggest that there is fetal anemia. So basically with fetal anemia, the velocity increases, the viscosity increases. So that is why you see this kind of picture. So this is the point as a message to all the obstetricians that at this point, you need the fetal medicine expert, and this patient can no longer be managed at a small setup. You need to shift the patient to a bigger setup with expertise of fetal medicine, a good NICU and a good backup.
So can I add one thing? I mean, this is not related only to RH, but I had one patient who was RH negative. First pregnancy was uneventful. Second time, she was isoimmunized, but her titers remained 1 in 16 throughout. However, I had referred her to a fetal medicine expert. Now, the we hadn't done, because here we don't do the zygosity of the husband. What happened was that the fetal medicine, the person who was following up, she picked up increased PSV and had counseled the patient for IUTs, but the patient had already reached around 35 weeks. And interestingly, when the patient delivered, the baby was RH negative. So I will ask Dr. Selva this question, that how come this woman who had ICT positive, of course, the fact that her titers remained 1 in 16 implied that she was not isoimmunized throughout the pregnancy. Still, her PSV, peak systolic velocity had increased, and the baby was RH negative. So what would you have advised, and what should we have done for this?
1 in 16 of titer, I would not have been really keen about going for any IUT. I would not have suggested, and especially when the baby is 35 weeks, I wouldn't.
No, she was being followed up. You see, I had referred her in the middle trimester only, and the ICT remained 1 in 16, and sab kuch theek chal raha tha, but when she picked up raised PSV, so she counseled, but because she was already 35 weeks, so I thought it's better to deliver the patient. And after delivery, the only thing that I did was I got the hemoglobin of the baby done. We always get it done. Although the baby was RH negative, still got the hemoglobin. Baby was anemic. So maybe it was some parvo infection or something. Googly actually.
The RH positive is a big twist in the story.
No, the baby was RH negative. That was the twist.
Ma'am, this is called amnestic reaction or something like that, no? There are two things, one sensibilization and amnestic reaction. In amnestic reaction, the baby is positive, but the antibodies are still positive. That is due to the previous pregnancy, the antibodies are there.
Yeah.
And in the sensibilized pregnancy, they say that in the early part of the pregnancy, you get positive antibodies, and then it keeps on at very high titers. That is because it is being sensitized by another RH positive baby. That is why when you get very high titers.
She was RH negative. Actually.
Yeah. Yours must be an amnestic reaction, I think. Amnestic reaction in which the baby is negative, and you find that.
Were keeping our fingers crossed. The ICT never increased. It stayed same.
Same.
However, the ultrasound monitoring, we monitored with the MCA, PSV. And when the fetal medicine expert thought it is you know, heading towards anemia. So she counseled. But what I'm telling that these varied presentations, one can never be very confident ki kya ho raha hai. Only we can be vigilant.
But ma'am, can I ask you something? I've got a patient whom I saw today. She said one full-term normal delivery with an IUD taken at the right time. And then she is now pregnant 20 weeks. And her ICT is positive 1 in 518. But so far, I told her maybe the baby might die because it's too early. But anyway, we'll see. We'll keep on. But so far, the peak systolic velocity is normal. I said, we'll check it again. And we'll keep our fingers crossed. If you cross beyond 24 weeks, probably we could send her for an intrauterine transfusion. And maybe we can try and salvage. But I gave her a very dismal prognosis, actually.
It is absolutely right.
Dr. Selva, would you advise chordosynthesis and fetal blood group estimation or whatever?
Madam, if we want to go for an IUT with all these reports, again, my choice would be most of the time we have to go for the chordosynthesis, ma'am. That is the place where you get the right value, and you'll be very confident that yes, you need to do the IUT for this baby. You can't just rely on the amniotic fluid OD, which zone it is coming, you know. More than that, it is so easy to just go directly and take sample and see the hemoglobin being
less. We want you to talk to us about IUT also. But before that, do different centers have different critical values for the titer? Like we are assuming 1:32 is the critical titer, but do the titers vary for different centers?
Yes. We use the 1:32 and then definitely wait for the PSV also to be normal. Don't want to take another risk of leaving the baby into a disastrous
state. And what about quantitative estimation of the antibody? Like they say the antibody level, if it is more than 4 international unit per IU per ml, then it means that this is a high risk babies going into anemia. So they say 4 to 15, more than 15 IU per ml means it's severe hemolytic disease, but less than 4 means it's not really affected. So if the ICT is positive, then maybe quantitative estimation may help. What is the opinion of the panelists?
Yeah.
The titers definitely may differ, Vishali. Yes, you are correct. For the NTD levels also could be taken. Yes. So, Madam said, her patient, they diagnosed that she is immunized and now they will be doing strict fetal surveillance and hopefully she should cross 24 weeks so that IUT can be planned for her. So that is the reason we keep repeating ICTs just to diagnose whether this patient is immunized or not immunized. So coming to IUT, Selva, you were telling us about IUT, intrauterine transfusion.
Two things in mind. When you talk about IUT, it's better after 20 weeks and the later it is better. You know, the earlier the need for IUT, the more chances that you will have to do repeat your transfusions and evaluation. So it's not going to be really great for the baby once early. So a middle onset or a late onset IUT requested would be better. So here, basically what we do is, we are all now very well aware of the procedures, the amniocentesis and everything. We diagnose, we locate the placenta, we see where the umbilical cord is coming from that. And easily with all the current machines and the Doppler facilities, can easily identify the umbilical vein and we stabilize and put the thing in the umbilical vein. But all we need to remember is in IUT, first of all, it has to be an O negative compatible blood and it has to be less than 5 days old. It's not just like that. You can do like a normal transfusion, which you do for the adults. You have to pay attention to each and every detailing. It has to be less than 5 days old and the hematocrit has to be more than 80%, because we choose it because the hematocrit value is less than 30%. So we need to make sure that the sample we are going to give for the baby should at least have a 80% hematocrit value. And then the amount of blood transfusion, it will be varying from 75 ml to 175 ml, depending upon the gestation age of the baby and the size of the baby. So basically, there should be no antigens and it has to be irradiated also. So only when all these things are done, the procedure might be simple, because for people who do cesareans and hysterectomies, just identifying it will definitely not be a task. But then there are so many other things which have to be focused before you do an IUD. And even after IUT, every 2 weeks, the baby has to be reassessed, and doesn't mean that one transfusion alone is going to save the baby forever. Constant monitoring. It's such a pain. One transfusion and people think that the baby is safe, and it is not like that. So suppose you start doing like how for madam's patient, if she goes from 24 weeks, you know, it's almost for 2 months, you have to be constantly monitoring her to see what is happening to the baby and how it is coping up also. So brief note on IUTs.
So IUT can be life-saving for the fetus, right, Selva? Done at the right time, I think even a hydrops baby has a survival rate of 90% or more.
We will talk about exchange transfusion. About the carnicterus and all that, we'll go for exchange transfusion also will be considered. But that is in extreme cases. To begin with, it is 1 in 32 titer, which will put an alarm on us, and we want to prod. And most commonly, Vaishali, once you say the ICT titer 1 in 32 is critical and the baby will need a transfusion, for me, I am practicing in a place where immediately they will think that you're going to give a transfusion, then please terminate the baby before it is 20. If it is 20 weeks, that's what they're going to tell me first. I can't do an intrauterine fetal transfusion. All these comes in repeated abortions, bad obstetric history, and by chance they've crossed 26 weeks, not even 24, 26, 28 weeks. And if we give them a promise that in 2-3 weeks, we will deliver your baby, maybe one or two patients will agree for that. But IUTs, in general, people still have the stigma that earlier, if you diagnose it earlier, I'm telling it like 20 weeks, before 24 weeks, nobody even is willing for a transfusion, even though it is a life-saving procedure in for many ways. We are forced to accept the parents' plea of no transfusions.
Right. Yeah, if I may add one more thing, it is said that no, we can give an intrauterine only after 24 weeks. But before that, if required, we'll have to give an intraperitoneal transfusion.
20 weeks.
Because we can't access the umbilical vein. They are so small and teeny-weeny. So we will have to give an intraperitoneal. So, I mean, I'm thinking of the possibilities for my patient because I don't know how far I'll be able to take her.
It's very difficult. You might have the best machine and the expert, but still the chances of playing the umbilical vein and then stabilizing it. It's not even identifying. You know, stabilization is the major thing.
Yeah, they give some mercuronium in.
For that, earlier 20 weeks, you will have to go through the placenta, the whole thickness, and go into the umbilical vein to stabilize.
Yeah.
You can directly go to the umbilical vein. In your patient, he's 20 weeks, you will have to cut through the entire placenta and go to the umbilical vein to make sure the thing is stable, the needle is stable. That is the most difficult part. It slips off and it's very... So intraperitoneal would be better for that.
I think the repeated IUT is also very, very frustrating for them. Repeated IUTs.
So message here is timely intervention, timely IUT can be life-saving. So even if the patient is immunized, everything is not lost. If timely intervention with the best of the fetal medicine unit, it is done, and where facilities for IUT in ICU facilities are there. So now you also spoke about exchange transfusion in severely affected newborn. So any of your centers are doing, any of our esteemed panelists can answer this about exchange transfusion?
Not doing, but I know
centers that. Centers the NICU, we don't do.
For ICTRUS, yes, definitely. Wherever there is ICTRUS, exchange transfusion for the baby is the only way to make the jaundice level come down. So exchange transfusion, the neonatologist will offer whenever there is possibility of a carnicterus or something. Yeah. I don't
remember. So as obstetrician, we hand over our baby to them. But the contraindication is cord blood bilirubin more than 4 mg per dl, Hb less than 11 gram per dl, rising bilirubin 1 mg per dl per hour, spite of phototherapy, or total bilirubin of 20 mg per dl or more. So your exchange transfusion can be done, and here again it can be life saving,
and earlier than late.
Yes.
Yeah.
And like IUT, exchange transfusion may be needed to be repeated. Post exchange transfusion care is also very important. Repeated phototherapy follow up, all that is very essential. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, what I wanted to say is that we focus so much on RH isomerization and jaundice, neonatal jaundice. But with mother O positive, also actually there is possibility of avian compatibility and severe jaundice. I've had patients where the first delivery of a O positive with husband B or A was okay. Some increased jaundice, but not so much. But second time we were prepared. So baby did go in for neonatal jaundice and exchange transfusion had to be done even for ABON compatibility. So yeah. In addition, that is just adding to, we already discussed RH quite threadbare. So I thought not to forget the ABON compatibility also.
And
well, in fact,
it is someone said anything?
No, in fact, it is said that if you take a total of 100, it is more than 2/3 is actually ABO incompatibility and only 1/3 is RH.
Right.
So ABO is so important.
So I thought that for the audience, it will be important that whenever I see my patient's blood group O positive, if the blood group is
relaxed,
O, then I make sure what's the husband's blood group and I warn the mother and the father that there may be more jaundice, more than the physiological jaundice. So I just thought that in addition to whatever we've already discussed, less that mentioned.
Yeah.
Ma'am, you're right, actually. They say that the max which an ABO would require would be just phototherapy, intense phototherapy. A small fragment of them only will require the exchange.
I've had kids who need
it. Yeah, we have also had,
That's why I thought, let's not forget.
That is a neonatal jaundice. But what about neonatal anemia? It's a milder form of hemolytic disease. But these babies may remain anemic for a long, long time, as long as 6 months till the antibodies are active. That is what has been documented. So now before we end last one or two questions, the panel's opinion about this sort of trick question. If this is RH negative patient, husband is RH positive, and they have been through 3 pregnancies and all 3 times, they've lost the baby because of the hemolytic disease. So what is the option for this lady?
Should go for an IVF.
Yes.
And get a negative baby.
Yeah. IVF. And the sperm should be from a RH negative.
Negative man.
And that is the only way out for this patient. There is no
avoid the isomerization.
So coming to the last, I think we are at the end of the panel. We've covered everything clinical, all entire RH negative pregnancy and such expert comments and advice from all our esteemed panelists. So I would like each one of you to give a take home message, starting with Ashwini.
Thank you so much, madam, for this opportunity. I think diagnosing it and creating awareness for RH negative pregnancy is very, very important. Because it is as devastating for the mother as it is for the child also. Because even the child requires a long-term follow-up, as you rightly said, for the anemia and long-term morbidities also. So I think identifying them and doing the ICT at the first visit is very important.
Yeah. Thank you, Ashwini. I can see Dr. Chinmayi also. Chinmayi, you wait. We are going to ask you also at the end. Dr. Sarina, ma'am, if you can.
No. I can just say that it is very important that we should check the RH factor in the babe, of the mother in the first visit. In fact, the onus lies on the obstetrician. It is our responsibility in order to reduce the incidence of hemolytic disease of the newborn. So I think we should monitor them very carefully and then take them on through pregnancy and then see that we deliver a baby without much of a problem. So the onus is totally on us.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Yes, Mitra, ma'am.
So I think one of the questions got left behind. So I'd like to address that. What are the precautions we should take as an obstetrician so that we do not MRP should be avoided? I think that's why I thought a question, right? Yeah. So
I know I skipped that question, but you are very alert.
Thank you, but actually you had given me the question, so it is easy. We should not forget that we should not increase any chances of fetal maternal hemorrhage. So MRP is a total no-no. And definitely as far as this delayed cord clamping and all, we have to weigh. Normally, now there is everything in favor of delayed cord clamping. Unless if we know we are expecting that the baby is immunized and we are expecting HDN, then of course we won't. But if it's a primary delivery and ICT was negative, anti-D has been given, so I think we should give the benefit of full, good hemoglobin to the baby. Right. Those were the two things I thought were important.
Initially, we used to say do early cord clamping for Rh negative pregnancy because the antibodies may cross over. But that has gone now. The newer guidelines by NNS say that delayed cord clamping.
Especially if it's a primary pregnancy and there isn't any isomerization, then it should be treated. The baby should be given the benefit.
Right. Yes, Dr. Ritu.
Yeah, I think the routine NTD prophylaxis must be followed strictly as it can bring down the maternal mortality, and also the routine NTD prophylaxis should be regarded as a separate entity and administered regardless of any, in addition to any of the NTDs given for the sensitizing events that are mounted.
Right. Well said. Yes, Selva.
So as a fetal medicine person, I don't want any RH. Abhi, as a fetal medicine person, I don't want any Rh negative mother to come to me, and I don't want to see any baby with any SIT or any pericardial or pleural effusion, or I don't want to see any halo sign, Buddha sign. I don't want to see any hepatocyte. Then 1.5. I don't want the titer to go more than 1.132. So we have to catch them very early and not allow them to go into that is what my take is.
Quickly follow with Selva.
Prevention of all this. Chinmay, are you there? We would like words from you.
I'm very much there. And like I said today, although Selva said that will be great not to have any of those signs, today we had this patient, we did the third transfusion for her. The first one we did around 26 weeks, and now at 31 weeks, we've had to do the third one, because her antibodies are so many and she's really suffering with this pregnancy. So indeed, we would not want to see a woman in that condition. But I think just giving the anti-D is not enough. Making sure that the anti-D has been maintained in a cold chain, because that is one of the reasons why it's failing. Lot of women who come to us who are isoimmunized give a history that they have taken anti-D. But incorrect storage of that anti-D, incorrect administration of the anti-D, inadequate dosage. Now, Clyhorbetke is not offered as a service by any lab, because you see, you will not require it on an OPD basis. It will always be required in an emergency setting where after a delivery, you want to see whether there has been a fetomaternal hemorrhage. So it won't be offered as a service. But if you talk to your pathologist, all of them, they will be happy to help you. It's just a slide-based test, and most of them can do it. So that acid elution can be done, and they can help you with the quantification, like Madam said, that formula which is there. They can help you with the quantification of fetomaternal hemorrhage. Luckily, 300 micrograms that we use is a fairly good dose. I mean, a good amount of fetomaternal hemorrhage can be covered. But anytime there is a doubt, it is a good idea to do that. If you don't do Clyhorbetke, most of our hospitals have flow cytometry now, because a lot of places are doing transplants and all. So we can get that information as well and use the adequate amount of anti-D. So just giving anti-D is not enough. It should be adequate and proper. And give it in the deltoid, not in the gluteal.
Yeah, I really appreciate your one thing mentioning, and that we all should start doing that, whether the cold chain has been maintained or not, because very good.
Chinmay, as a fetal medicine expert, what advice would you like to give us obstetricians?
Oh, all of you said that. No, your baseline ICT definitely, because that is what absolves you. The moment you see ICT is negative, then the Rh negativity is a moot point till that stage. Once the ICT becomes positive, and like you mentioned, actually to do ICT before giving anti-D, but the catch is after you give one dose of anti-D, you may have an ICT positive. It may be very weakly positive after 6 weeks. So that may not be enough to carry on for beyond 6 weeks. So that is why they are timed at 28 weeks, 34 weeks, and then post-delivery, which is expected around 40 weeks. So even if it comes positive, you should go ahead and give your second anti-D there. We actually don't do ICT after giving one dose of anti-D ever in pregnancy, because it's expected to be positive, and sometimes it leads to unnecessary anxiety.
Yeah, yeah, that's a very interesting point you said, Chinmayee. After
the titers will be low, Chinmayee.
Yeah, very, very low, very low. Very actually, low, when that very comes, very many times we get referrals for ICT positive, and when we inquire, we come to know that they've already taken anti-D. So the yes, only way to reassure them.
4 IU per ml, it is very low.
Basically. Very low, very low, and it doesn't increase. And somehow the labs are able to help us. They can tell us that it's not significant.
Yeah. So I think wonderful take-home messages by everyone. And I would also like to emphasize about one point we didn't discuss in detail is when patients, we get a lot of patients for medical MTPs and who are Rh negative. So when should you give this patient anti-D? Would you like to give with the MTP pill prescription there and there itself, anti-D dose? Or what would you like to do?
They should be given.
Give us their answer. Madam, you are the senior most here who will have that answer for us.
No. For example, even in a threatened abortion, they say the first bleed. So whenever we start invoking the initiation of abortion, so the earlier given, the better.
So with when on OPD basis, we are doing medical MTP and she's Rh negative, please, please don't forget to give her anti-D. This is where we miss as clinicians. Many times we miss giving anti-D over here.
So the dose might be a little lesser, ma'am. Would you be okay if we gave 150 instead of 300 in the...
Yeah, that is enough because the amount of fetal maternal bleed is very little, extremely little. So even a small dose is enough.
Is enough, yeah. So this has been a wonderful panel. I thank you all and I'm truly grateful to all you esteemed faculty for accepting to be here today evening in spite of your busy schedule. So thank you, Mitra ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Ritu. Thank you, Sarina ma'am. Thank you, Ashwini. Thank you, Chinmayee. And
Selva.
Selva.
And I think we should thank our moderator for having conducted such a lovely panel. You have covered everything.
Definitely. All the credit.
Very straightforward questions. Very practical.
Yeah, very practical.
I enjoyed, you know, Dr. Vaishali. You really deserve...
Thank you, ma'am. Thank
applause.
You.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Applause for all of us. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you, our organizers. Thank you, Science Integra TOG and Bharat Serum. Thank you. I request Ashwini to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you, thank you so much, Shari, madam. I thank all our speakers, the esteemed guest of honor, the chairpersons, and all our panelists for sparing their time and making us academically more rich. Thank you so much once again, Science Integra and ICOG for granting us the credit hour. So see you all soon, in person probably.
Thank you.
Thank you for thank being you. There. Yeah. Bye. Thank you, Vaishali, madam.
Dr. Vaishali, Chinmayee. Thank you. Bye. Thank you, Serena, ma'am.